I would like first to thank all the organizers to invite me to this opportunity, or to give me this opportunity to present the microscope, and also to thank a lot Thibaut for all his participation to microscope also. And before beginning this presentation, I would like to just a personal tribute to Pierre Touboul, who passed away this year. He was the principal investigator of this mission, and of course he puts a lot of his time and enthusiasm to build up this fantastic mission. Okay, so I will give you some general overview of the mission, but maybe some of you already know. I will focus my presentation on some topics of the data processing that leads to finalize the results that will be published very soon. And I will in particular focus my talk on the two last points, the systematic error analysis and the satellite cracking, which disturbed us quite a lot during the data process. Okay, but before, it's like a movie, you have a prologue, in fact. And before presenting microscope, I would like to remind you some details, in particular when I was a young man in the 90s. I start to participate to the STEP project with Pierre Touboul, and of course, Thibaut Damour was in the team also. This paper is maybe was published in the 2000, but the project, the first idea of the test in space comes out from in the 70s, and in the 90s we had a lot of enthusiasm to build a cryogenic satellite to test the equivalence principle. So the STEP mission was led by Professor Francis Isvrit in Stanford University. And in the 90s also, Thibaut published a nice paper on the string dilator on the least coupling principle that inspires, that gives us a lot of ideas to make experiments in space. And in particular, in this paper, he mentioned that we could eventually see a violation of the equivalence principle at a level between 10 to minus 14 to 10 to minus 23. So it was a large range, I have to admit. But at this time, we imagine a lot of people imagine some missions like Mini-STEP in Stanford or STEP. In France, we start also to study GeoSTEP with the CNES, the Space French Agency. In Italy, Anna Nobili was imagining the GG mission. And all these missions were about 10 to minus 17 or 18. But this accuracy cost a lot in terms of time, in terms of money, of course. And it was quite hard to achieve and very challenging. And that's why we take the opportunity in 2000 to the opportunity of the of a space mission in a microsatellite. So the microsatellite gives a quiet environment to test, to make physics in space. Maybe not as accurate as the STEP mission, of course, but with after several analyses, we thought about to get 10 to minus 15. And we start the project like that, saying that maybe it's not the best mission we could achieve, but maybe in a short time, we could achieve something that could be a first pass to test the equivalence principle at a much better level than the one performing in ground, on ground. So you can see first participation of Thibaut in ONERA. In the journée scientifique de l'ONERA, which was linked to the Académie des sciences in France. And we have a nice book published at that time. And during all this, at the beginning, we thought it would be cheaper, faster, and so on. But in fact, it's not so cheaper, it's not so faster, or not so smaller, no, either. But we had a lot of numerous pitfalls during this long path to get the mission flying, and at each time we had the contribution of Thibaut in particular in science working group of microscope, but also during the main announcement of the results, for instance here in 2017 for the first results. He kindly participates to this press conference. So let's come back to microscope. So very quickly describing the project and after some results. So the microscope is mainly a French mission, but with European contributions. For instance, for the propulsion system, we need a propulsion system to control the acceleration of the satellite. So it is a cold gas system provided by ESA. We had also some apparatus, the possibility to test the instrument in free fall, because our instrument is not testable on ground. So we had to provide a microgravity environment to test the instrument. It was performed in ZARM. And I just had to mention too that to test a microscope, we perform more than 200 free falls in Bremen, thanks to the participation of the microgravity laboratory in Bremen and the DLR cooperation. And we need also, you know, we want to test two bodies in free fall, and these two bodies are made of material, and this you will see this material on the test masses we would like to test has to be built with very high accuracy. So we have chosen the physics institute in Brunswick to produce and develop the test masses. And of course, in ONERA, we cooperate with Observatoire Lacoisière since a long time, maybe 50 years of cooperation on all geodesy topics and satellite tracking topics. Of course, here in microscope, more than 25 years cooperation. So, very quickly, some basic figures on microscope. So what we would like to do is to compare the acceleration of two bodies that are maintained concentric in flight by applying electrostatic forces. So we would like to compare the acceleration applied to the two test bodies. We have two test bodies of different materials, so platinum and titanium alloy. And in this particular configuration, we are in inertial pointing. You see that we will see the projection of G along the axis of the cylinder, which is the measurement axis. We will see this projection at one time per orbit. So the frequency of the test is the orbital frequency. And we compare, so if we have a violation, we will see a difference of acceleration at this frequency. We can also We can also spin a little bit the satellite in the opposite direction of the orbital motion in order to increase the frequency. So just to mention that this increasing the frequency is better for an instrument because we have a better performance. So the satellite is a micro satellite, even if it is a little bigger than the regular micro satellite. Micro satellite is 1 meter cubes. This one is a little bit bigger. It's about 300 kilograms, and it was launched at 700 kilometers. So what we'd like to measure is an acceleration of 7.9 10 to minus 15 meters per second square, if we would like to measure delta G. So this is very challenging, because it at that time, in 2000, when we started the program, we have never measured such a low acceleration. So we use an accelerometer, in fact, so the two test masses or the two test masses of an accelerometer, which is based on the technology we developed for many other missions, in particular for geodesic missions like GRACE or GOCHE mission. We use the same principle, but in this configuration, we have two concentric test masses surrounded by electrodes that control the motion of the test mass. So I will not detail this diagram. It's just to say that we have a servo loop that controls the test mass motion, and the servo loop is a digital servo loop that enables some different configurations in flight to test in different configurations all the systems. The satellite operates at different attitudes, motion. So in particular, when we spin the satellite, we have two spins of the two spin rates, and so we have two EP frequency of test for the measurements. The instrument is at the core of the satellite. In order to minimize the distance of the instrument to the center of gravity, so we minimize this distance, and also to have a particular care of the thermal housing of this instrument. So it is in kind of cocoon, thermal cocoon, that stabilizes the temperature of the instrument. So we have a satellite with different equipment on board, in particular the instrument, which is in fact a six-axis accelerometer. So we measure the trilinear acceleration or the triangular acceleration. The angular acceleration is hybridized with the star tracker to control the attitude of motion of the satellite. And the linear acceleration is used by the drag free controller to counteract any external forces applied on the satellite, like drag, radiation pressure, or albedo pressure on the satellite. And all this controller is led by the onboard computer. And this is particular. It's a particularity to have all these loops working all together in order to have a very quiet environment on the satellite. And you have here on the right of the screen some figures, typical figures of performance of the drag free. So the satellite has an environment of 310 to minus 13 meters per second squared. It was the environment seen by the instrument in flight at around the EP frequency, so very, very quiet environment. And the angular motion was very low also, about in acceleration, in terms of acceleration. So you have here four picoradians per second square. So very nice environment to test the equivalence principle. And we need this performance, in fact, you will see why, because in order to limit all the different defects of the instrument that could project any common mode disturbances on the differential acceleration. So the satellite, after a long path of development and difficulties we have to face, but we solve all. We launched the satellite in April 2016, and we switch off the satellite in October 2018. And at the switch off, we deployed two wings. You can see in the small movie the two wings deployed on the right of the video. You have an optical view taken by the a telescope in Observatoire de la Côte d'Azur with a technology developed by ONERA also, adaptive optics implemented in the telescope in the south of France. So this is, it was the real video of the image of the Microscope satellite. So after this switch off, we had to data pro. We have a certain time to make the data process, but just giving you some figures. So we have more or less 2.5 years, but on 2.5 years we accumulate more than 13,000 orbits. But within this 13,000 orbits, we have only 20% usable for the science. The other orbits are, in particular, eclipse. We have eclipse period during the orbit, so that cannot be used for science, for instance. We have also moon flares. That means that during we have sometimes the moonlight coming on the star tracker, and we have to depoint the satellite in order not to. To have too much light on the star tracker. So also this period is not usable for the science. And we also have the commissioning phase, so it is a regular thing for satellites. And we complete by technological experiments on some available time when we do not perform science. So at the end we have two configurations of the satellite, two speeds, two spin rates, and a certain number of orbits for each configuration. And just coming back to the first publication in 2017, so we demonstrate with only one session, so about I would say 120 orbits. It's about 7% of the total science orbit. We demonstrate that we have no violation of the no evidence of violation at a level of, I would say, 10^-14. On this level was so it's the result of the data process of only one session of only 120 orbits, but we have we have statistical effects, so stochastic errors on the data process, so we hope to reduce this statistical error by accumulating more orbits, so we can gain in the square root of the time of measurements, so this one can be okay. The other one, the systematic error, cannot be reduced by only accumulating data. On this systematic level was in fact an upper bound limit of the systematic error, because we at that time we didn't know how much the temperature varies inside the instrument, and we don't know because we don't see any signal in fact. So we see only the noise of the temperature probe, and we need more orbits to evaluate the real temperature, so to accumulate statistical error on the temperature probe to see if we see any peak at this EP frequency. So at that time, the limit, the knowledge of the temperature variation was 15 microkelvin because of the noise of the probe. But nevertheless, only with this result we could put a limit on the light dilatant. It's something we published in 2018. So I will not go in these details in the equations. I think you're much better than me at this game. So I'll just put the two the two parameters in a potential web violation, which depends on the charge of on the charge different charges here linked to the two materials, on each charge linked to the proton and the atomic number of the material. And you can see here that we constraints the values of the two parameters in entering in the scalar field coupling to matter. So we reduce by maybe one order of magnitude with respect to all the other experiments. So to go quickly to the data process, so what we measure is it's something we would like to measure is something proportional to G. So the difference of acceleration should be collinear to G. But in reality, you can see that we have a lot of disturbance. So the bias, offsets, drifts, systematics. And we have also effect of the gravity gravity on the inertia gradients because the test mass is not perfectly concentric. We have also effects of common mode projection because the test mass are not perfectly aligned. And we have noise on the quadratic terms and so on. So the parameters in blue, the disturbance, can be calibrated in flight, so it's something that is good. And also the gradient and inertia gradients can be also corrected because we can estimate very well the miscentering in flight by a calibration process. So, but the most difficult was the systematic error, as I presented in the previous slides, in particular the thermal variation. So we performed dedicated sessions to validate the thermal filtering process estimated on ground with some models. So the model says that the Earth's albedo disturbs the one radiator in one part of the satellite that transmits temperature variations to the our electronic box and after to the sensor unit. So we perform some experiments on in flight to establish the, I will say, the transfer function, the thermal transfer function of the different parts by tilting a little bit the satellite to increase the apparent view of the Earth's albedo to the radiator. And with this experiment, we demonstrate that we estimate the filtering effect, and we estimate that the temperature variation inside the sensor unit will be by of about 0.1 microkelvins, so about 100 better than we expected, than we estimate for the previous publication. So that leads to a systematic acceleration at the end, about 9 × 10⁻⁵ meter per second square. So in terms of adverse parameters, so you divide it by 8, and you have about 10⁻⁵ in terms of adverse parameter. So we reduce by quite one order of magnitude in terms of systematic error with respect to the previous publication. And it was not the end of the story because you had also trouble with cracking of the satellite. So you can see here a cracking. So it's a kind of transient acceleration that has the bad idea to be at the same period of the expected signal. But the good thing in that thing is that this is a transient signal, not a periodic signal as a sine signal as we expect for the delta G. So we can detect this kind of peak, like here, with a classic sigma clipping tool, and eliminate about 15 seconds of measurements in order to eliminate the impact of this glitch. But eliminating data means also we have to our data process, on primary data process is not robust to missing data, so we had to use a specific, a particular method that reconstruct the signal, the missing signal, with the best estimation of noise. We replace this part by a noise that which is the best representation of the noise surrounding this event. And with that, so we have tested some sessions. So the problematic was, okay, we eliminate some data, but what about an eventual adverse parameter violation if we eliminate also this signal? So what we perform, we introduce a fake signal in the measurement. So we added in the differential acceleration a fake signal. So with different amplitudes, you can see here, so 34, 10 to -15. In terms of parameter of this, we have also introduced a very small 3.4, 10 to -15. And in all cases, we pass the data processing. We try to run the same thing as for the real data. And we have shown that in fact it doesn't impact any this signal. So the data process gives a good estimation of the fake signal introduced in the measurements. And you can see here we eliminate about the maximum is 28% of the data, but the reconstruction gives a deviation of less than 0.2% error in the estimation of those parameters. So we are very happy to see that all this data process is robust to the elimination of some data. And in conclusion, so we have passed more than 2 years better estimate the systematic errors. So we have a paper which is being under review in classical quantum gravity with respect to these aspects. And we have also, by accumulating a lot of orbits, I cannot say the results of the equivalence principle. What I just can say to you that we improved the first publication by quite one order of magnitude, and we hoped very soon to give you the final results. So all the papers, we have a special edition in classical quantum of, containing about 11 papers. And about 8 papers are already accepted, and only the final result is under review today. Okay, so happy birthday, dear Thibaut. Thank you very much for supporting Microscope. It was a great help for us. And I will just finish with this sentence. I think fundamental physics makes engineers like me dream and encouraged to take up new challenges.
Well, thank you very much.
Thank you. So there is time for questions or comments. When will it come out, this final paper? Of course, it's under review, you say, so.
Okay, we have a paper. The final is under review internally on the science working group. Maybe we could submit it to CQG within a few weeks. It's quite ready, it's just, and I think, depending on the review, with the experience of the other papers, I think by the end of the year we'll have all the papers accepted. And after, it's just a question of the French Space Agency CNES to organize a press conference. So we have to coordinate the press conference with the release of all the papers in CQG and PRL, because we have also a PRL paper. So the two editors are okay with that. So we have to coordinate this release.
So all these are excellent news.
Oui.
Ah, je ne sais pas comment.
Tu vas donner la parole.
Pardon? Oui.
Tu vas donner la parole.
Très bien, merci. So there is a question.
Ok.
Je vais dire en français.
You have shown several archive references in the archive.
Yes.
What is the best outcome of this? This you can tell because already public, you see.
In fact, all the archives do not contain any results, final results. Just, but it helps a lot, for instance, for the satellite description, the instrument description, how we perform the validation of the instrument. All these topics are very important to have more confidence on the published results at the end. So that's why we prepare a special edition with a lot of topics, and some of these topics helps a lot to understand how the final results come out.
Mm-hmm. Well, thank you. So there is a question.
Yes.
No, it was already answered by the talk.
Okay. Thank you.
Fine. So thank you very much again.
Thank you.